strong life for us. Poor old dog, he suffered through. But he had I believe he had cancer. And he started convulsing. He's taking it kind of hard. The other dog is taking it hard because the other dog has never known life without him.
Yeah.
They were born 1 year apart on the same day. So we'll see what happens. We may have to get another companion. Because I'm getting kind of old to walk around on all fours. All the time. We may have to get another one.
That's so sad.
But that's not a... Incidentally, I do believe that pets go ahead. Speaks to it, and there's also another one in Ecclesiastes that speaks to that whole idea. And I don't think like you can't find the scripture pets go to heaven, but there's definitely an inference, and I know that the most important part is to make sure we're going to be in heaven, because then if they go to heaven, we're not there. That's not going to work out very well. But God wants to make us as happy as he possibly can. And I don't know if that's part of making us
there
happy.
There you go.
But just think, he's going to come back on horses, so we have horses.
Well, I know. I do believe, I don't think anything that God created, he will allow to not exist anymore. I don't believe animals have souls. Don't take that. I don't. But, dogs are unconditional lovers. They love you even when you're you. So, but.
If you feel a wet nose on your forehead tonight.
Huh?
If you feel a wet nose on your forehead
tonight. Yeah, we're going to watch out for those antichrist dogs. Okay, so what other prayer request is there? Of course, we're still praying for Jim. We're still praying for Margaret. We're praying for Pat Cooper.
I talked to Ellen yesterday. There's some real hard days. Pray for John. She would like to go. John is not ready to let her go. But her skin is tearing so bad. Got bad bleeds, and where she's not bleeding, there's that water.
She's oozing.
So,
the elders were going to try to go over
and
next
she
week
has
and
to
anoint her with oil.
She has to be in pain.
She'd love that.
She doesn't talk.
Yeah.
She does about pain.
I know she doesn't, but I know she's tired. And
yeah.
She sleeps a lot.
Yeah. Who else are we praying for?
Marcia's nephew.
Her sister-in-law's, he's a stepson, actually, I think. Adopted son.
Darren. Oh, gotcha. Yes.
Yeah, she has cancer.
What kind? Do you know what kind?
Right. Ron asked for prayer for Jose last night.
He's really asking a lot of questions.
Valerie, of course. Remember Valerie?
And the Bronze.
Nikki and Bob that don't have complete recovery from their knee surgeries.
We need to touch base with Chris and Renee. What's going on? I know Chris is working.
Yeah.
And I think Renee was working today.
She was working today.
Yeah, I saw her yesterday.
I'll
call. Yeah, somebody else to call.
Who else? Remember to talk up the concert on the 27th, so we'll have some folks here. And then, of course, sunrise service. We will have sunrise service. We'll have the brunch. church, and then we're done for the day. There won't be an evening service on Resurrection Sunday. Okay? Anybody else for prayer requests? Okay, let's stand. Ask my brother Ted.
Our Heavenly Father, again, we come to you and thank you, Father, for all your goodness and your mercy that you show us. We thank you for each one who's here. We pray that each one might be healthy. Pray that those, Father, that you mentioned Pat, Jim, Marshall's nephew, Mr. Bond's friend, we pray, Father, for all of us. Pray you be the speaker, Mickey, and know the hurt that you're going through. And pray that you would strengthen, help, heal, and that you would make it easy. Pray, Father, tonight as we participate in this lesson, that you would help us, Lord, to know what to say, when to say it, and how to say it. The example of Jesus gives us a real insight of how to talk to you. We thank you, Father, for Jesus and the upcoming Easter Sunday, as we know that this was his resurrection, for that he gave his life, and for that he gave it for us, that he might save all that would come to you. Thank you again, Father, for today. This is our prayer in Jesus' name.
So we're going to continue with our examination of the prayers of Jesus, and then probably finish these tonight, and then I want to look at some people of prayer. There'll be a couple of the Bible people I'll look at, and then I think I've mentioned I'm looking at starting another series in a few weeks. So. But remember, as we examine these prayers, we're examining them by category or by giving, I've tried to give each group a name, and then we're looking at them for a theological significance and then a personal application for our own lives. So turn to John 12, and somebody read John 12, 27 and 28 for us, please.
Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour, for for this purpose I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again.
Amen. Is that the one you mentioned last week, sir?
Uh-huh.
That's the third time that God speaks, I guess we can say audibly, to Jesus in the scriptures. There's the baptism, transfiguration, and then this time as he contemplates his immediate future. And I call this a prayer that's offered up in the midst of tension. Okay? And what we have is a situation where, remember, just because he's Jesus doesn't mean that he's different than us in regards to the emotion he feels, to the stress he feels, to the tension he feels. And at this particular moment, if you look back a few verses, it says in verse 20, it says, now there were certain Greeks among them who came up to worship at the feast. So those Greeks are, I would imagine, Jewish proselytes. They have been won over to Judaism. That's why they're referred to in that way. They had come to worship at the feast, it says. And they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee, and asked him, saying, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. And Philip came and told Andrew, and in turn Andrew and Philip told Jesus. But Jesus answered them, saying, so Jesus knows what's going on, okay? He tells them the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. So, at the very moment that these guys coming to him. Do you think Jesus has a desire to see these guys? I would imagine he does. But due to the circumstances, he has to be about what he has to be about. And he uses this phrase in 27, my soul is troubled. Make sure we all get a chance to sign that card, okay? So that we can get that to Jim later. But he says, my soul is troubled. So what is his soul troubled over? That he's going to the cross? Yeah. And that word, when you look up that word troubled in the Greek, it actually means he's horrified. And I think the horror of it comes from the idea that he knows, as the sinless Son of God, that he's going to have to go to the cross and carry all those sins. And he is horrified, I believe, by that thought. You know, Jesus understood, I think, very easily, and was, I think he was much more receptive of the physical aspects of his end time than he was of the spiritual aspects of his end time.
Do you think he knew that the Father was going to turn his...
I think so. Yes. I think he did. I think he had that recognition. So, Jesus knows he's about to take on our sins, the sins of the world, and in his sinless state, he's repulsed by that thought. Still, as he reflects, though, as you read his word that Ted read to us, he says, Father, save me from this hour. Yeah. Okay. But, and then he says that word, but, which is the most important word there, he acknowledges his mission on earth. And what is his mission on earth? Glorify his Father. The mission is the same, right? Isn't our mission the same? The missions are the same. So, this is the principle by which Jesus lived his life, to glorify his Father. And it would also be the principle by which he would die, to glorify his Father. So, from a theological perspective, that's what we can garner from that. And for our life application, we can see that no matter what the circumstances might be, even though Jesus was in this time of where he says that he was troubled, he was still taking the time to communicate with his Father. He's caught between a rock and a hard place, but he's still communicating with God. And notice that he gets an answer, but he doesn't get a resolution yet. But he does get an answer because his father replies to him and says, I have both glorified it, and will glorify it again. What is it?
His name.
His name. And there's a real interesting sequence in Philippians about the results of the cross, and that's actually one of the results of the cross. But okay, so the next one I want you to look at, Luke 32.
But that's the next one.
Yeah.
He did come to glorify, and I'm not arguing that at all, but he came for so much more as far as death on the cross.
Oh, yeah.
He came for us.
Yeah. That's why, you know, in what we're studying in Romans, Paul has belabored the point that we are adopted children of God. And now he's going to start this, in this next two verses we're looking at, he starts speaking to the idea that we are joint heirs of God. And when you really consider what that really means, first of all, to be an adopted child of God, is so inadequate to the gift that we have. And then, when say those words, they come off our lips very easily. But what that really means is a very profound thing. So yes, there's a very big umbrella under glorify God. He came to make you sinless. And he came to glorify you as he is glorified. And that's, see, the church has lost part of some of that sight that Christ came so that you might be glorified as he is glorified. Now, how that works, now, don't take that wrong, because the Mormons take that to mean you can be God, and you can't.
Yeah.
But how that works, what that means, is very hard for us to grasp. But because as we walk down the path of sanctification, as we look in our mirror day by day, we're supposed to look a little bit more like Jesus every day until glorification. And then we will be as much like him as we will ever be. And a lot of these, I was reading Lloyd Martin Jones the other day, and he's a real advocate of the idea that if there is salvation, it has to be glorification. And you know, that's what we believe as a church, because we believe if you're saved, then you can't lose that salvation. So for anything, and it's like I think last week when I closed, I said God has the power to save us, and there is no other power that can take that away. Not on heaven, not on earth, not anywhere. So, yes, but you're right, Betsy. There's a lot involved in that. But look at Luke 22 for me. 31 and 32, if somebody will read that for us. Luke 22, 31 and 32.
Simon, Simon, Satan has said to sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you, Simon, that your faith may not fail, and that you have turned back, strengthen your brothers.
I really like this. This is a prayer for an apostle, in essence. And we can, from a theological perspective, we can glean a few things. First, as reflected by Jesus' word, evil is not an ultimate power. Okay? Evil cannot function in a vacuum, I'll say. What evil has to do when it functions is that it has to have permission to function, if I can say that, if I can use that word. The Lord said, Simon, Satan has asked for you that he may sift you as wheat. And see, okay, I won't go there yet, I'll go there. I love the way one thing I really like, it's like, do you remember when you used to get a mother in trouble with your mother and she would use your middle name?
Yeah.
Now, Jesus calls him Simon, Simon. Who named him Peter?
Jesus.
But Jesus wants to make sure that he understands. I want to get your attention here. Simon, Simon. And it reminds me, my middle name is John, and my mother used to. There were a few times I remember her saying Stephen John. And what Jesus tells him is a very, very somber warning of impending trouble. And I want you to notice that Jesus' prayer, everyone, he says, I have prayed for you. And has Jesus prayed that he not be sifted?
No.
No. Jesus, sorry. Sorry, but you get sifted. We always get sifted. The secret to success in life is how you respond to the sifting. Okay? Because everybody gets sifted in certain ways a lot of the time. So he doesn't pray that he not be sifted. He prays that his faith won't fail. And another theological thing is that we can see the intercessory prayer of Jesus here. Jesus prays. He intercedes for those that believe in him. And so we know the picture. Satan asked, can I sift Peter? And Jesus says, Simon, Simon, I've prayed that your faith won't fail. So how did Peter do? Peter didn't do it. At the sifting, he wasn't real successful. But you know what? His faith did not fail. And if there was one, you know, I kind of like Peter. He's kind of an in-your-face kind of guy. If there was one apostle, though, if there was one apostle that needed a touch of humility, a touch of humbleness, it was Peter. And it made him that much more of an apostle. And if you remember now, what happens in Acts? He really conducts the first revival meeting in the Bible and is very, very successful at it. So for us as individuals, we can say that when we pray, our prayers might not be answered in a simple way. Sometimes, we mentioned it before, and I want to mention it again, sometimes it's a process. And there's an end result to that process, and we just have to be faithful to keep going through the process. Although Peter did deny Christ, he came back a wiser man. He was a humbler man because he had been sifted. And then the last thing is that, again, it's theologically important to understand. It's also very important for us individually as persons to understand that Christ is interceding for us. Okay? He's there. He is speaking on our behalf to the Father. Next. Yes.
That last verse, it says, and when you have returned to me, God already tells him, I'm trusting that you're not going to kill.
Yeah, so, and that's an important point for us to understand when we speak to other people. You know, it's not if you will return, it's when you return. That's the way I look at it. When you counsel with people, you always have to be in that frame of mind. John 14:6. Okay. If you look at that, somebody. Go ahead and read that for us.
And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever.
Amen. So, when I read that prayer, I ask myself, did Jesus need to pray? I'm sorry.
16.
You said it wrong.
What did I say?
You said 16.
Oh, it's 14:16. I'm sorry. Good. That's good.
You just hadn't caught up with
me. I have a sheep.
So, when I read that, I say to myself, did Jesus need to pray that prayer to convince God to send the comforter?
No.
Okay. So then I ask myself the next logical question. Why did he pray that prayer? If he didn't need to pray that prayer, why did he pray that prayer? And why was it important for us? Because really, there's a lot of references in the Word, in the Gospel, to Jesus went off and prayed. Jesus went over here and prayed. Jesus went over there and prayed. Anytime that you are enlightened as to what he really said, like the next one, because the next one we're going to look at a whole chapter. He prays for a whole chapter. Anytime that the words of Jesus' prayers are illuminated to us, remember illumination we've been talking about in can see what it is the Lord has for us. So right here we have Jesus praying a specific prayer, asking for the Father to send the Comforter. And why, if he didn't need to pray that prayer?
Because their relationship was so close. The three persons are mentioned here, and it's a relationship. And they talked about everything.
It's
always.
It's a relational relationship.
Yeah, that's what
ultimately,
I was trying to say.
Ultimately, only God speaks to God.
Yeah.
That is,
so if it's God,
Jesus is our representative, and he goes to God for us, and we go to Jesus.
Yeah, I think, and yeah, I agree with both of you.
He was telling them and reassuring them.
Yeah. See, from a theological point of view, I'll tell you that Jesus needed to be involved in the will of God.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because he is God.
Yeah. Yeah. So, Jesus prays for the Comforter. And what's the, what does it say? What kind of Comforter is it?
The Helper.
It's called the Paraclete.
Another
Comforter.
And that in Greek, that word in Greek, another, means one just like...
Another of the same kind.
Yeah, the same kind, another of the same kind. Have you ever heard that phrase, on the wings of a prayer? Have you ever considered what that means? Have you ever thought about, I think about on the wings of a prayer, and that's, see, when I think of the wings of a prayer, I think of a prayer floating around, okay, and it's in God's will, and that's what's propelling that prayer, because it's going right along with the wind that is propelling it, the wings of a prayer. And that's what this is. Jesus is, if I could say, verbalizing, concurring with the will of his Father. And for us, the life application is that that's what we're supposed to be doing all the time, is seeking our Father's will in our life so he can accomplish in us and through us what he wants to do. It's like what we've been studying in Romans. When we have certainty, when you have certainty of the Spirit's presence in your life, then you have a relationship. What Paul has tried to teach us is that we then have an Abba Father relationship. Okay, and when we have that Abba Father relationship, it produces in us what God desires of us. And that's why, I know I belabor points on Sunday mornings, but it's not me. It's what Paul has written, because he wants us to understand the richness that God has for us. The idea that we can be glorified is a very rich idea. So there's a lot of richness in this one prayer for us. Look at John 17. And... we looked at Matthew 6 and Luke 11, which some people call the Lord's Prayer, but I call it model prayer. This is really the Lord's Prayer. If you want to know, if you want to model your prayer life after anything, this is where you would go. And it's a chapter long prayer where Jesus prays for himself, he prays for his disciples, and then he prays for us. Jesus prays for us here. And I think it's important that we invest the time to read it. So if somebody would read verses 1 through 5, please.
After Jesus said this, he looked toward heaven and prayed, Father, the time has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on earth by completing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. Okay.
6 all the way up to 19, please.
entrusted your name to the men whom you have given me out of the world. They were yours, you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they have known that all things which you have given me are from you. For I have given to them the words which you have given me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I come forth from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I do not pray for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. And all mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them. Now I am no longer in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to you. Holy Father, keep through your name those whom you have given me, that they may be one as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in your name. Those whom you gave me, I have kept, and none of them is lost, except the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, because they are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, that they also may be sanctified by the truth.
Do you think it's important not to be of the world?
Yes.
And then somebody finish for us 20 through 26, please.
I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through the word, and they all may be one, that they all may be one. You, Father, are in me and I in you, that they may also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me, and the glory which you gave me I have given them, that they may be one just as we are. Just as we are one, in them and you in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved me, them as you have loved me. Father, I desire that they also whom you gave me may be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory which you have given me. For you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, the world has not known you, but I have known you, and these have known that you sent me, and I have declared to them your name, and will declare it, that the love with which you love me may be in them, and I in them. That was good.
Well, as you know,
that's awesome.
You know, that's so rich that it's almost hard to, for me to.
I like that passion for glorifying them with the glory which I have.
It's almost hard for me to even look at it without starting with the first word and going through the whole thing, but there is a lot of significance for us. And, you know, I've mentioned that it's very revealing to hear Jesus pray, how he prays. And you got to understand that with a Catholic Church, when you, this is a prayer that you would hear typically. Church. There was that great richness upon which the Catholic Church at one time was founded. And what we have here is Jesus really chronologically, okay, theologically, is making a transition. What's the transition?
To him being absent from the realm.
He is concluding his earthly ministry. And now, here in this prayer, we see the beginning of his new ministry, which is intercessory prayer. Okay? When you hear these prayers for his disciples, prayer for other believers, you see the beginning of his focus switching from going around and preaching to everybody. Now he's beginning to intercede for people. And we hear Jesus, even though he's very repetitive, there's a great amount of confidence that he expresses in his Father. And he
He expresses a great amount of confidence in his followers. He does. The only one that he has anything bad to say about is, oh, what's his name? The son of perdition, Judas. But he expresses a great amount of confidence in everybody else. And there, and when you read, when you in, if you would sit down and read this prayer two or three times, and so you did get a good flavor for the words, especially so you could read it fast, you would see the urgency in this prayer. Because what happens next?
Oh, come get him.
He's arrested. The next thing that happens, so and Jesus knows what's up. So there's a great amount of urgency in this prayer. This prayer was probably prayed within 90, 120 seconds. I think he was just, this was the tantamount. At this particular moment, these were the things that were most important on his heart. And so there's a level of urgency that we need to see for ourselves in a practical way. Look at the way Father... the way you, the only true God, O Father, the way he refers to his Father throughout this one chapter is Holy Father. He refers to him in all these different ways, and that is so rich for us to see. And I would pray that we would get those same words to come out of our lips, you know, because if Jesus prayed that way to God, boy, it's going to be good for us to pray that way too. And I'm not saying to pray the prayer rote. I'm just saying that the way he speaks of the Father, of his Father, you can feel the love coming out of what he has to say. And
but he has great expectations for us.
Yes, he does.
Those expectations are unity.
Yes, he does.
He wants
yes, and that's my next point. I'm sorry. No, you go ahead. Because you're exactly right.
The only way we're going to show the world of our difference is our unity. Does that mean we will agree on every point? No. But it does mean that we are united in him at all costs. And that we get along one another.
Yeah. Even when it's rough.
Yeah.
You know. And that's that was my last point. The divine importance of the unity of the faith. That is divinely important to Jesus because it reflects upon him and his Father.
Unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. That's it. Yeah.
And Jesus so shows, so we need to have trust and confidence in each other. Even when we may not feel like that's something that we might feel in our emotions. And I tried to emphasize this point. Love is not a sentimentality. Not as God operates. Love is an imperative. It's a rule by which you live your life. But look at the next prayer. And I call this, look at Mark 14. Somebody read Mark 14. We're not going to be finished. Mark 14, 32 through 42. Somebody read that one. Mark 14,
32 to 42. Then they came to a place which was named Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. And he took Peter, James, and John with him, and he began to be troubled and deeply distressed. Then he said to them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch. He went a little farther and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. Then he came and found them sleeping and said to Peter, Simon, are you sleeping? Could you not watch 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The The spirit truly is ready, but the flesh is weak. Again, he went away and prayed and spoke the same words. And when he returned, he found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy, and they did not know what to answer him. Then he came the third time and said to them, Are you still sleeping and resting? It is enough. The hour has come. Behold, the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise up, let us go. See, my betrayer is at hand.
Matthew 26, 36 through 46. Somebody read that for us. 26, Matthew 26, 36 through 46.
Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, Sit here while I go over there and pray. He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little farther, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Could you men not keep watch with me for 1 hour? He asked Peter. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak. He went away a second time and prayed, My Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done.
Luke 22.
I've got three more verses here. I'll keep on a little soon. So let me read this. When he came back, he found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. Then he returned to the disciples and said to them, Are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour is near, and the Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer.
Okay, then Luke 22, 39 through 46.
Coming out, he went to the Mount of Olives, as he was accustomed, and his disciples also followed him. When it came to the place, he said to them, Pray that you may not enter into temptation. And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's throw, and he knelt down and prayed, saying, Father, if it is your will, take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Then an angel appeared to him from heaven, strengthening him. And being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. When he rose up from prayer and he had come to his disciples, he found them sleeping from sorrow. And he said to them, Why do you sleep? Rise and pray, lest you enter into temptation.
That called hematridrosis, when blood is excluded in the perspiration. But theologically speaking, what we have here is an intense, intense prayer. And I thought it was appropriate that we read all three because it's that time of year. And this is, and being in agony, it says, and he prays earnestly, it says, he expresses his, see, Jesus, one thing about this prayer, that there's no doubt, he's honestly expressing himself. You hear the words, Father, if you will, take this cup from me. What's he asking? What is it that Jesus fears? Separation. He has the knowledge. acknowledge that he's going to have these sins placed upon him. It's not the crucifixion. It's not the beating. It's not those things that are weighing on his mind. What's weighing on his mind is, and don't be misled. He's not struggling to accept God's will. That's not what's at stake here. What he's struggling with is what he knows is going to happen, and he knows it has to happen. He's resigned to that fact, but he still expresses himself in an honestly emotional way. And that's a good thing for us to understand. Think back to the Psalms. David praying in the Psalms. There were times that David was mad. There were times he was upset. The only emotion that I think that is detrimental in prayer is when you act like a spoiled child. There's no place for that in prayer. But these other emotions, joy, sorrow, intenseness, all of these things are okay. And Jesus was accepting of the knowledge of what he had to do, but in his acceptance, Jesus knew, okay, so Jesus is praying this prayer, take this cup from me if you will, all these things. Jesus has one thing that is reassuring. He knows his Father is listening. And there's no surprises going on here. But he knows his Father is hearing him. And in fact, his prayer is answered through the process that will take place. And sometimes, remember, we ask for relief from burdens, but instead of relief, what you get, this is an important point, is the strength to put up with the burden. He doesn't guarantee he's going to take that burden away, but he will give you the strength to shoulder that burden.
My grace is sufficient.
Amen. It is. It is.
Luke says the Father sent an angel to comfort him.
Amen. He needed comfort. Yeah. We need comfort. And he will. He will do that for us. Okay. One more, and then I'll stop for tonight. I've got three more, but we'll look at one more. A prayer of great forgiveness. Look at Luke 23:24. So, theologically speaking, Jesus is a man of forgiveness. If I'd been in Jesus' shoes, my prayer might not have been the same.
You'd have called down the field back.
I'll probably talk about it Sunday night. Remember what Stephen prayed when they stoned him? He asked for their forgiveness. Now, later in Revelation, those souls are going to be under the altar, and they're not going to be praying for forgiveness. That's because the time has changed. This is the time of grace. That will not be the time of grace. And God is totally justified in his actions in regards to those prayers. We'll look at that Sunday night. But theologically speaking, Jesus is the greatest example of a man of forgiveness. And in this prayer, see, really, when Jesus said, I want you to consider this. When Jesus says, Father, forgive them, who's he praying for? I think he's praying for all of us. He's praying for all of mankind. Father, forgive them. And by his subsequent action, that forgiveness will be realized. Okay? Jesus' death on the cross provided forgiveness see, for me personally, when I look at this prayer, I see this terrible, terrible situation, and yet Jesus is asking that his persecutors be forgiven. And for us, that's the example that's contained in the prayer. I can get upset with people. I can get mad at them for a little while. But the thing about people is that we don't know them the way God knows them. We don't understand them the way God understands the truth. And see, people have gone through things and had things happen in their life that we have no idea about. And thus, whenever we're confronted by a situation where it's easy for us to get angry at one another, it's really, what we really need to do is try to be more understanding of each other. Because they do not know what they do. You hear those words? They do not know what they do. Father, forgive them. And that's that idea of understanding each other is a very important idea. It's a very big idea in the ability to forgive. Because we don't know each other, and we don't know what's happened to each other. So we need to be more forgiving of each other in our own idiosyncrasies. Because we all are idiosyncratic in some way or another. So, I better stop there. Besides, running out of time, I'm running out of voice. So, but any thoughts, any comments, anybody? Thanks, Joaquin, for coming tonight. You're always welcome. Anybody else? Yes?
I think when Peter preached his sermon in Acts, and he said, told the people, he said, you have taken in your wicked hands and crucified and slain Jesus Christ. The response was, men and brethren, what shall we do? And many of them were saved at that day, the same man who crucified Jesus Christ came to repentance. And so, prayer was answered.
That's a good thing to consider. That some of those that put Christ to death, I believe undoubtedly were some of those that were saved at Pentecost. Because I think when you take into consideration all that happened, as you read the word, all the miraculous things that started going on, that some of those guys had to have second thoughts.
Well, even one of the guards. I just finished reading for I don't know how many times. No wonder they call him the Savior, but by Max Lucado with his potato this week and bullet.
Yeah, that's a good book.
Yeah, it is.
Max Lucado's a good writer. Okay, anybody else? Let's stand. Join hands if you can.